Cybersecurity is one of those that every single company has data it needs to protect. And so it doesn't really matter what industry you're in. You know, if you're in business, you've got sensitive data. That sensitive data might be personally identifiable information, which would be on employees, you know, customers of your business, whatever that be. It might be protected health information, which is governed by HIPAA. It might be credit card data, or it might be proprietary information like the Coca-Cola secret formula, that type of thing, something that, you know, makes your business unique and distinct. All that needs to be protected.
Welcome to Business Ninjas, brought to you by WriteForMe, where you'll hear from business leaders who are out there growing their business and slaying it every day. Learn from the masters. Let's get started.
Hi, and welcome to another episode of Business Ninjas. I'm here today with Mark Burnette, Chief Growth Officer at LBMC. Mark, how are you today?
Andrew, I am doing great today.
Excellent. I appreciate you spending some time with us on Business Ninjas. Please tell us a bit about yourself and about LBMC.
Sure. Well, let me talk about LBMC first. We are a professional services firm. That's a fancy word for an accounting firm. We are one of the top 40 largest firms in the U.S. and offer a full suite of business services to our clients, everything from tax and audit services to a number of different consulting services designed to help businesses achieve their overall business goals. Now, my background is actually in cybersecurity, and that's one of the consulting services that our firm offers. I've spent nearly 30 years in the cybersecurity industry, and as my career has evolved, and then here at the firm, I've moved into a growth role, and I'm sure that's a little bit about what we'll talk about today, is how someone goes from being a cybersecurity practitioner into leading growth and sales.
Gotcha. But I always feel like an outside perspective is invaluable in an industry where, I'm sorry, but everybody has sort of the same view and perspective and approach, and a tiny sidestep can be invaluable, right?
Absolutely.
What's the origin story in LBMC? How long they've been in business?
Yeah, we formed in the 80s. We're actually, as we speak, celebrating our firm's 40th year, 40-year anniversary. And so we've had a number of fun activities planned in the markets where we have offices to celebrate with our clients and with our colleagues. And the origin of the firm was we were started in Nashville, Tennessee, and with three basic premises. The first was the founders of the firm felt strongly there needed to be a firm that focused on the Nashville market. Back then, Nashville wasn't seen as a top-tier city, and so some of the larger firms didn't have large presences there or a whole lot of expertise in the market. And so the founders of the firm said, we want to do that. We want to build a firm that's going to have expertise in the market to serve the business owners of Nashville. Then secondly, they said, we want to have a firm that has an entrepreneurial spirit. And as we find business problems that we believe we're equipped to solve, we're going to adapt and try to solve them, you know, within the bounds of an accounting firm's capabilities. And then thirdly, the other thing they wanted was in the 80s, and it's less true today, but still somewhat true. The accounting profession, particularly during what we call busy season, is pretty intense. And so, you know, people were working many, many hours. And in the 80s, if you came in as an accountant, the profession either chewed you up and spit you out, or you made partner. That was kind of how it was. And they felt strongly, our founders felt strongly, that there had to be a way for people in our accounting profession to be able to pursue their personal passions outside of work, have a decent work-life balance, but also work hard while they're at work. And so those three principles were what the firm was founded on. And today, we're thriving as the city of Nashville has continued to grow. We've grown along with our clients and with the city to become one of the 40 largest firms in the country.
Well, hey, congratulations on the 40 years. You're describing, you know, the secret sauce that makes things worth, the all-elusive work-life balance, right?
Yes, and I, you know, no one ever gets it perfect, but I'm proud of things the firm has done. We've made a lot of decisions along the way that are different than what a lot of our competitors are doing, and it has created an environment where not only do we continually get best places to work, we celebrated yesterday 5 straight years of being a national best place to work, but our retention rate of our employees is much higher than in the accounting profession as a whole. So we use those two measures as evidence that we've got to be doing something right with the work-life balance.
Excellent, excellent. And hey, Nashville has exploded in the last 20 years. I know property values are probably double today what they were just 5-10 years ago, if not more. And now you're chewing on LA levels of traffic from what I experienced on my last visit to Nashville.
That's right. Yes, it's been a lot of fun to watch the city grow in the years that I've been here. And yes, the traffic is unfortunately getting worse and worse. And frankly, I think a lot of Californians who are relocating are choosing Tennessee for lots of different reasons. So they may be giving up one difficult traffic circumstance to come to another.
But somehow the traffic is comforting because it makes them feel like home.
Oh, maybe. I don't know. That's for them to say, not me. It's not comforting to me.
Which verticals are you servicing? Who are your clients at LBMC?
Yes, we'll provide services to any business that needs the services, but it won't surprise you to know that we have developed a lot of industry expertise. Nashville is considered the healthcare provider mecca of the country. There are more hospital beds controlled out of this city than any other city in America. And so that is an area of expertise that our firm has developed over the years and represents a very significant portion of our firm's business in all three disciplines, audit, tax, and in our advisory services discipline. In addition to that, we've got a good bit of experience in retail, in manufacturing and distribution as well. And then, of course, as an accounting firm, we have a focus on high net worth individuals. There are a number of services we provide that help those individuals manage their businesses and their finances well. And then technology. The technology companies, you know, Nashville is starting to become a little bit more of a technology hub. And we've been proud to be able to get to work with a lot of those technology companies. Your listeners may have heard that Larry Ellison of Oracle just announced that Nashville is going to be the world headquarters. And needless to say, there were many trumpets and trombones and that were played in Nashville in celebration of the great news. And we're really, really excited to welcome Oracle to Nashville.
Yeah, they never say, hark, sound the saxophones, right? Well, hey, I appreciate that. What are the most common problems you're solving for your clients?
In my case, my area of expertise, you know, is advisory services, as I mentioned, and specifically in cybersecurity. And so the things that I'm focused on when I'm interacting with clients with my discipline of expertise are really around helping them find and protect the sensitive data they've got in their organization. And now that's industry agnostic, Andrew. I get asked a lot, hey, do y'all focus on industries? And here's the thing. Cybersecurity is one of those that every single company has data it needs to protect. And so it doesn't really matter what industry you're in. You know, if you're in business, you've got sensitive data. That sensitive data might be personally identifiable information, which would be on employees, you know, customers of your business, whatever that be. It might be protected health information, which is governed by HIPAA. It might be credit card data, or it might be proprietary information like the Coca-Cola secret formula, that type of thing, something that, you know, makes your business unique and distinct. All that needs to be protected. And so I typically, when I'm working with clients, am advising them on how to think about protecting their data and systems. And then, of course, we've got teams of people that can assess the controls they've put in place to see if they're functioning. But we also have teams of people that can test those controls using things like penetration testing techniques and then conducting risk assessments to figure out where their cybersecurity risks are so that they can make sure they've got a reasonable set of protections in place to protect their business.
But that's quite an undertaking these days, especially in the healthcare sector. I don't see anybody dealing with ransomware more than the healthcare sector. And if I read correctly, the vast majority of them just pay out because the exposure is too great. And they, you know, their machinery are now Wi-Fi. There's so many things going on that if you shut them down, people's lives are at risk. So they just pay and move on.
There are a lot of, obviously, that's a decision that each company has to make based on the circumstances. And, you know, most organizations try to put some resilience in place. They'll have backups and different things like that. And really, it comes down to whether or not their resilient capabilities, they think they can restore them and get back to working order and have data that's trusted and reliable. And if not, then you're right. They may find themselves in a difficult circumstance and decide that their best course of action is to pay the ransom. Interestingly, you know, you'd think this is kind of one of those things where the bad guys think like business people, because you'd think that the bad, you know, you'd go, well, why would you pay the ransom? Because you don't know who the bad guys are, right? They generally want it paid in an untraceable currency like Bitcoin or something like that. And you don't know who they are. So you pay them, and there's no guarantee they're actually going to give you the key to unlock your, you know, your locked data. But the bad guys figured out quickly, if we take payments and we don't give the key, people will quit paying. So we should probably give them the key, like be people of our word, ironically, give them the key so that they'll pay us the next time we're able to successfully infiltrate and lock their system. So that is typically, not always, but typically we do see that the bad guys will indeed provide the key and then the company's able to unlock its data and move forward. Now, with that said, there's still the responsibility to notify, and that's a lot of the things you're reading about are because there are breach notification laws. Yep. That obligate organizations to notify affected individuals, you know, when there's been a breach.
I believe you just described honor among thieves, which is a whole other rabbit hole to go down.
That's right.
Let's switch gears for a minute. The pandemic had an impact on everyone, both positive and negative. In a business context, I'm not going to get into anything else about it, but tell me about the challenges and opportunities of trying to grow a business through a pandemic.
Oh, man, Andrew, you're right. Of course, you know, since our business is largely consultative, we're interacting with clients. When the country shut down, it was difficult, if not impossible, you know, for us to interact with clients. Of course, it was difficult, if not impossible, for those clients to run their businesses either, with the exception of the critical industries, which, you know, stayed up and operational. And then, but we took a bold step. Again, most of the professional services firms said, hey, we're gonna kind of jettison some staff and all that, because most of us were sitting idle for periods of time. But we felt strongly that, keeping with our mission of people first and all of that, that we were gonna hold serve. And so not only did we not have layoffs during the pandemic, but we gave raises. We actually, you know, we gave a raise. And so what happened then is, as businesses started to come back online and the economy itself was picking up, the businesses were hungry to move forward and recover what they lost. And so we were in a great position because we had the resources to respond quickly, whereas a lot of our competitors had to hustle and rehire. And so it took them a while, and that gave us an opportunity to work with some businesses that previously we'd not gotten a chance to work with because their normal providers didn't have the capacity. And so, and then, in keeping with our model of putting clients first, we ended up keeping those clients. And so that really amplified our growth. And I can't say, we certainly weren't sages, Andrew, to figure it out, but it was a bold move that our CEO recommended to our board and that our board took. And it certainly paid dividends early on for our firm as we continued to grow. And then the second thing, of course, when you think about a consulting business, is really keeping your ear on the market and seeing what services companies need, you know. And so generally, if you're lucky enough to become a trusted advisor, you can talk to your clients and tell them, hey, what's your business challenge? You know, what's on your mind? And a lot of times, and this is how our firm grew, the client would say, we're really looking for an expert who can help us do this or solve this business problem or, you know, address this. And it's really then, well, do we think that's something we could do? And if so, would we be willing to put, you know, the good name of the firm behind it? And if the answer to both of those is yes, then let's go do it, right? And then all of a sudden you end up with a nice service capability that you can offer to other clients. And so we've been opportunistic to keep our ear to the ground and see what our clients are telling us their business problems are. And then if we think we have the expertise in-house or have access to it, then, you know, we've taken the opportunity to either buy or build a new service line and put that in front of our clients and invest in it and let it grow.
Nicely done. Hey, you know, people don't talk about karma in business, but I think if you treat your business like you treat human beings and you treat them well and you nurture them through the bad times, things tend to work out on the other side. And it looks like that's been the case at LBMC.
We've been very, very blessed, lucky, and certainly, we're grateful to have all the great clients that we have and the team members that, you know, I forged ahead and serve our clients so well.
Hey, in music, they say the more you practice, the luckier you get, right?
There you go.
You can refer to it as luck, but when you have
that is a good analogy. I agree with you. That's right. Practice, I guess you could say it eliminates the need for luck, right?
So there you go. Well, I'm not going to go that far. So what differentiates you the most in the market? What makes LBMC stand out?
I would say probably the most significant thing is our niche is we tend to be the what I would call the best value for the dollar. And what I mean by that, Andrew, is that there are going to be firms that are larger than us that, you know, on paper have more capabilities than we do and, you know, bigger name clients and things like that. And they cost more, you know, and so certainly there's going to be organizations that say, I've got to have the big name because the significance of this project, you know, merits me having a name that's, you know, recognized worldwide. And then there are firms that are much smaller than us that, you know, have a niche capability and that type of thing. And they're typically less expensive. And in some cases, they may be even pushing to commoditize a service. And we've made the decision, we don't want to chase the commodity services because the resources that we have are true subject matter experts, and we believe there's value in that expertise. So we've stood firm behind the fact that we're not going to chase rates, fees, and things like that to the bottom. And if we're going to maintain our subject matter experts and we're going to pay them fairly, then that means we've got to make sure that we are getting fair fees for the expertise we're bringing to the market. And so we've carved out this nice little niche in the, or little, you know, kind of space in the middle where we generally say we're less expensive than the big guys, but we have the same expertise because many of us, like myself, came from those larger firms. So, you know, we have the pedigree, the knowledge, you know, and all of that to bring to bear the same that you'd get, you know, from a bigger firm. But we have the sophistication, the methodologies, and the quality that a smaller firm can offer. So that's where we try to play. And so, you know, thinking about sales and growth, Andrew, how that manifests itself is when we're talking to a prospect, we've got a couple of qualifying questions that we'll ask them on that initial discussion. And based on their answers to those questions, we'll decide, is this the type of organization that's going to appreciate the quality we provide and willing to pay our fees? And if the answer is no, then what we're probably going to do is just, you know, nicely direct them to a provider that's going to be better suited for what they're looking for right now. You know, and I'll use the example in cybersecurity. There are some firms who, you know, they'll get a business partner who'll say, we want you to have a cyber audit, you know, and so they'll specify, get an audit. And we'll get a call from that prospect and they'll say, we'd like you to, you know, quote us on this particular audit service. And we'll say, sure, we'll ask them some scoping questions. And then once we do that, we say, okay, well, based on that, generally, you know, what you told us at a high level, an audit for those types of, for that type of scope would probably cost in this range, you know, a fee. And we can, you know, we can talk more details about and get it specific, but this is what it would cost. What do you think? And if they go, whoa, you know, we found, you know, Joe's audit service down the street that said they do it for, you know, a few thousand dollars or something like that. And then, you know, we go, okay, well, you know what? Joe's is probably a better fit for you right now based on what your goals are. If you're looking to just check a box, then that's not us because you're going to get value out of what we bring to the table. And yes, you'll be able to check your box with your vendor and with your regulators. But more importantly, what you're going to come away with is quality and value for your dollar that actually helps you achieve your business goals, you know, protecting sensitive data, you know, maintaining a cyber posture that's you know, good for your board and your executive team. So that's an example that we use, and it will help us avoid chasing prospects that, you know, aren't good fits for our firm.
Hey, I love your approach. You're describing a company that is self-aware and has self-respect, but also appreciates that not every sale dollar is a good sale dollar, right? Not every business relationship is supposed to happen. They're not all fruitful down the road. I appreciate that approach a lot.
You know, and of course, I will say, you know, the counterpoint to that, and we talk about this a lot within our ownership group, a lot of times there will be considerations where we'll make a special decision to say, hey, this client, they're a small, they may be not willing to pay our fees now, but what we see is they're going to grow quickly. And, you know, we think that this is the type of company that will grow into the firm. And as such, we may make, you know, concessions in certain cases to say we'd like to be a part of their business journey. Or it may be a client that we say this is the type of client that would be a great client for many services within our firm. And of course, you know, in our business, you want to become a trusted advisor. And when you offer a breadth of services, your goal is that the client is, you know, using lots of your expertise, right? Not just one of your service lines. And so we spend a lot of time on cross-selling. And so in some cases, again, our strategy might be, this is a type of organization that we think would be, you know, using a lot of our services. And as such, we may make a fee concession in the early stages to land that organization, prove our expertise, build some relationships so that we can have the opportunity to position some of our other services with them and grow.
Excellent. What role has content played in the growth of LBMC? How are you telling your story?
Oh, yeah, man. I tell you what, that is something I am very passionate about, Andrew. In our business, we don't sell widgets. We offer expertise to the market. That's what we have, people expertise. And so content is really important because we have to demonstrate to prospects that we are subject matter experts, because there are plenty of firms out there that do what we do. And so how do we differentiate ourselves, right? I told you we got this. We believe we're, you know, in this best value for the dollar thing. But how would a prospect know that? We can say that about ourselves all day, but, you know, they're hopefully going to talk to some references who would validate it, but they're going to do their research on the internet, and they need to see that we've got subject matter experts that are, you know, publishing information on the internet, that are involved in, you know, doing blogs and speaking at major industry events and things like that to share our expertise. And not only that, I feel like it's a duty and a responsibility for those of us when we build a subject matter expertise to share it. And so content plays a very heavy role. And as I was building our cyber business within the firm, we had a very intentional strategy around content. And so we would develop a content calendar, and we would assign subject matter experts within our cyber discipline and say, hey, we want to make sure we've got at least, you know, one or two pieces a month that are on this type of topic, and then another one on this type of topic. And so we would strategize and make sure that we were building that content so that we had it and we could publish it at a good schedule where our clients would see that, yeah, they know what they're talking about. And then secondly, the benefit of content for us would be when we go to events, and particularly industry events where it's an event that's required for the type of service we provide. Not all of our competitors are there, and we'll use it as a differentiator. I'll give you a great example. Just a few weeks ago, I was with our team that's responsible for credit card security. We were at the Payment Card Industry Security Conference, which is the annual conference put on by the credit card brands that talks about credit card security requirements. And one of the things we always do is we'll put a note out to our clients and we'll say, if you'd like a private briefing when we get back so that you can hear what we heard, we're happy to do that at no charge, because that's a benefit you get as a client of ours. And so we do develop content on that, but sometimes we'll even have a one-pager, and we'll use that to have a meeting with our clients and walk them through the one-pager. And of course, Andrew, what we're hoping is, one, it's going to remind them, LBMC cares about me. They've got my best interest at heart. But two, hopefully it'll prompt them to ask some questions that might lead to us to engage and provide some additional support to them as they move forward, you know, in their credit card security goal, you know, with their program. So it's certainly, you know, twofold, but we love the idea that our clients know that we're out there staying up to date, and that the information we're bringing them and the guidance we're giving them when we do work is based on the newest regulations, and they're going to be in a position to be successful.
Hey, you're speaking our language. We preach intentionality all day long. You know, we're in an era of noise. Everybody's got content, but legitimate subject matter experts, you know, speaks volumes. And you're in an industry where the yard line is moving all the time, right? Legislation changes, tax laws change. So there's a lot for you to stay on your toes about, and people right. have to trust you and know that you know what you're doing.
I appreciate it.
Let's look down the road a year. What are some things you'd like to be celebrating personally and professionally?
Our firm, as I said, we're celebrating 40, and that's been a fun celebration this year. But when we think about moving forward, in our industry, there are a lot of changes happening. Private equity is starting to take some ownership in certain accounting firms. And frankly, you know, we're seeing that change a little bit of how those firms choose to go to market versus the traditional firm model, where the partners are the owners and operators of the firm. You know, and we've made a decision. We're proud of being fiercely independent. We think there is a real benefit to that. And, you know, back to a differentiator, gives us the flexibility to make decisions that are in the best interest of our team members and our clients. that, you know, we might not have if we had outside investment. And so when I think about moving forward, number one, we want to continue to be celebrating that we're fiercely independent and thriving. And so, you know, to do that, it requires us to make sure that we have a good strategic plan, which includes, of course, an approach to growth. And but then also the strategic plan, which includes operational measures that are going to help us maintain, you know, our ability to move forward. Things like, how do we make the requisite investments in technology without overburdening our overhead costs? You know, that's a difficult balance, right? Yeah. In our profession, there's an expectation that we stay up to date with newest technology and that we're leveraging innovations to, you know, be more efficient. And so, you know, we're working behind the scenes to look at the types of solutions that could help us be more efficient. And in theory, you know, the solution and the implementation of it may cost some money, but if we can be more efficient, then it, you know, it works itself out, right? Because it requires us less time to deliver those services. And so the types of things we're trying to automate are the repeatable tasks, the mundane things that a lot of times, you know, when you think about what happens in an audit or in a preparation of a tax return, there's an awful lot of what we call setup, which is important to make sure that things go well. But frankly, it isn't where our experts are delivering subject matter expertise. You know, it is simply an administrative task. And so we're looking for ways to say, how can we automate those things? And that way you eliminate human error as well, because a computer's not going to make a mistake. It's going to, you know, do it the same every time. And we can free up our subject matter experts to truly provide expertise. Not only that, Andrew, then that gives them more capacity to do that expertise, right? So that's an example of something that we're doing now. So, you know, what are we looking at going forward? Well, we want to continue to be fiercely independent, resilient, and thriving as a firm, just as we are now. And that requires us to keep our eyes on the ball and also keep our ears to the ground to look at what our industry is doing and make sure that we're ahead of the curve where we can and that we're even with the curve, but certainly we don't find ourselves falling behind the curve, because we know that we would lose our competitive differentiators and our edge if we allow that to happen.
Hey, it's the nature of your industry, right? You can't just develop a skill set and stay there. It's just not tenable, right? There's too much change. There's, again, tax laws are a moving target. You got to stay ahead of the curve. Yep. Again, I repeat, I appreciate the approach. Tell us, please, what's your URL? Where can people find LBMC? And what social media outlets are you using these days as well?
Yes. So we are, it is LBMC.com. So www.lbmc.com. Used to be Lattimore, Black, Morgan, and Kane. That's, you know, the origin of the name. So hope folks will check us out there. And we are heavy on LinkedIn is the primary outlet that we're using. And, you know, as in our business, we're finding less engagement on the what I would call the personal social media outlets, Facebook, you know, Instagram, some of those things. Now, obviously, we do a lot with Twitter as well. But what we are using Facebook for, Andrew, and you'll be interested in this, is we've established an alumni network. So folks have worked with our firm who've gone on, you know, to other careers. And the beauty of those alumni is many of them become clients, you know, because they appreciated their time here. They appreciate the approach we take. And so we want to make sure we stay connected to them. So Facebook has been a great way for us to connect with those folks and keep them engaged in some of our alumni events that we're doing and get them back with the firm. And not only is it fun for those of us who used to work with those folks to see them and shake their hand or hug their neck, but it's great to ask them what they're into. And then, you know, frankly, see if there's a chance to work together again.
Excellent. Hey, Mark Burnette at LBMC, all the best to you and yours and continued success at LBMC. Thank you for spending some time with us today on Business Ninjas.
Andrew, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure. I've enjoyed our conversation. And to all your listeners, stay secure.